Good morning. Thank you for coming out to share in this service of thanksgiving for the life of John. We're going to commence this morning's proceedings with a series of tributes, starting with a poem from Olivia Yearwood.
Good morning, friends. The name of this poem is A Psalm of Life. Tell me not in mournful numbers, life is but an empty dream for the soul that slumbers, and things are not always what they seem. Life is real, life is earnest, and the grave is not its goal. Thus thou art, to dust returneth, was not spoken of the soul. Not enjoyment and not sorrow, ends our destined way and our way, but to act that each tomorrow finds us farther than today. Art is long and time is fleeting, and our hearts, though brave and stout, still like muffled drums are beating funeral marches to the grave. In the world's broad field of battle, in the barbeck of life, do not be like dumb driven cattle, be a hero in the strife. Trust no future, however pleasant, let the dead past bury its dead. Act, and act in living present, heart within and God overhead. Lives of great men all remind us we must make our lives sublime, and departing, leave behind us footprints on the sands of time. Footprints that another, sailing o'er life's solemn main, a forlorn and shipwrecked brother, seeing shall take heart again. Let us then be up and doing with a heart for any fate, still achieving, still pursuing, learn to labor and to wait.
And now we make a Harrison College Old Boys connection as we get a musical tribute from a gentleman who knew him from school days and also played hockey with him through life, Mr. David Weatherhead.
Thank you.
And now a tribute from the Harrison College Old Boys hockey team. We welcome Mr. Andy Bourne.
Good morning. John Griffith, or Claus as he was affectionately known, was an intelligent, humble man who by his discipline studied and worked hard, and as a result achieved much in his really too short life. His long-term friend Neville Graves always saw him as a quiet, easygoing, humble man who loved justice and a good joke. From his humble beginnings growing up in the city to his academic and professional success, John showed by his example that discipline, hard work, and perseverance have their rewards. Neville noted that in academics, John was a school and classmate who diligently pursued the knowledge required for him to reach the top of his chosen professional discipline. And as a professional, he was professional, given of his time to lead tutorials in accounting at the University of the West Indies, and to mark weekly assignments for the professional accounting body of which he was a member. I can't remember when I first met John, but as Ralph Thorne reminded me in his Facebook comment on my post, re John's passing, John and Andrew Small were like a twin, two friends who reveled in each other's company and did almost everything together. Andrew played hockey with the school team and later for Harrison College Old Boys, and John joined as well. We spent many evenings and Saturday mornings practicing and or playing at various grounds, striving to perfect our game. As a member of our Harrison College Old Boys hockey team, John was a skillful, strong, fleet-footed, and aggressive forward, and his left-handedness was an asset which allowed him to dominate playing from the left side. And these assets always gained him a first pick, as we custom say, on the team. John possessed a very powerful shot, which when it came off would leave opposing goalkeepers with little chance of saving. I said when it came off because, as with most good forwards, John missed more chances than he scored. Some of these misses would leave us with our mouths open, as we would often wonder, how could he just not have scored and missed such easy goals? But I can say with certainty that he was much better than that Belgium forward, Lukaku, who missed every easy scoring chance he had on their last game against Croatia at the last World Cup this week. I can imagine the jokes we would have had discussing that game. Lukaku? You mean Lukaku miss? Luka miss, you mean? Or even Luka missy? That would have been his explanation to the name of the Croatian forward, the Belgian forward. But let me not digress. John practiced very hard, and often we would, after completing our team practice on Saturday mornings, visit other hockey team practice grounds to play. That discipline and dedication to his game, he carried through in his study and work life. We enjoyed many years practicing and playing, but we especially enjoyed the camaraderie, jokes, and discussion after these sessions. John enjoyed volleyball as well, and on the volleyball court, he was mainly a hard-hitting spiker, as Neville reminded, giving it his all for the Church of God team in their many efforts to be crowned champions in the embryonic years of the sport in Barbados. Later, he was later involved in the administration of that sport, becoming the president of the Barbados Volleyball Association and leading it through its most successful period, winning many Caribbean championships. That John would later become the treasurer of the Barbados Olympic Association, helping that organization to improve its funding, was a testament to his dedication and commitment to everything he involved himself in. Valance Lynch reminded me that John used his initiative every year that Harrison College Roll Boys participated in the Banks Hockey Festival to get a sponsor for the team so that they could compete. Some years even ensuring that Barbados National Bank, to which he was an employee, sponsored the team. Such was John's commitment to the sports he enjoyed, and he always treated to them seriously. John gave his all in every aspect of his life, but he didn't do it alone, for Carol, his wife, was often and always close by, giving encouragement, support, and of course, licks for bad or sloppy performance when warranted. Thank you, Carol, for your love and support which enabled John's successes. To us at Harrison College Roll Boys and to YMCA, John was a friend and good hockey player whose playing at times exhibited greatness. To the Barbados Olympic Association, he was a great treasurer, and to the volleyball fraternity, it can be said that he was a legend. To Erica, he was her loving dad. To Carol, her handsome husband, the man of her dreams. But to Barbados's homeland, he was a treasure. We all are, and Barbados is the poorer for his passing. Rest in peace, my friend. Rest well, for you have earned it. In Dio Fides.
Next, we invite Mr. Kenmore Bino of the Barbados Volleyball Association to come and pay tribute.
Good morning, everyone. It is ironic that since I noticed the failing health of our friend John some years ago, I began the mental preparation for this day. When Carol called me on that fateful Sunday, I reluctantly accepted that this assignment was due. Yet, days later, and perhaps given months or even years, I do not believe that I can appropriately outline what John meant to us in the volleyball fraternity. John has not only been the longest serving president of the Barbados Volleyball Association, holding the position from 1996 until 2018, but he has been our greatest president. As the sole scribe of local volleyball history, I can say that without contest, since I have been privileged to observe the work of 9 of our 10 presidents. John did not run volleyball. John led, inspired, and grew the individuals who ran volleyball in Barbados to create an executive whose work and achievements became the envy of other associations locally and throughout the region. We often speak with great pride of our golden era when Barbados men won 10 regional titles and our women captured 6. What many persons do not know was that John was responsible for the genesis of that success. In 1990, Barbados received a wildcard entry to participate at the CAC Games in Guadalajara, Mexico. The Barbados Olympic Association indicated that a penniless BVA would need to contribute $1,200 to each ticket for each player, and our president at the time rejected the invitation. As the then treasurer of the BVA, John indicated that he would find the money and that our men would attend CAC. We did attend, and of course, our men were beaten by the likes of Mexico and Cuba, with our sole victory being a straight sets win over Jamaica. However, that experience prepared us for a higher level of competition to dominate the region and to set the template for both our men and women to qualify and perform creditably at Norseca, Pan Am, and such like competitions. John not only brought a level of professionalism to the BVA's executive, but he also revolutionized our senior national team programs, where he instructed the players to focus on training and leave the raising of funds to the executive. Those of us, and there are many older sports persons here, would remember when selection was often based on who raised the most money through sponsor worksheets or just plain begging. In 2001, John also created greater envy in the region when Barbados became the first English-speaking Caribbean island to host the Norseca finals. Some 21 years later, no other Caribbean island has been able to match that feat. John, taking such positions as Vice President of Cazorva, Treasurer of Norseca, and the internal auditor for FIVB, which is the international body, was not about aggrandizement for John. Our president recognized the value of the old Bajan saying that if you're working in the kitchen, your children would always get a share of food. And John's greatest interest was in the children of volleyball, where he established the BNB Juniors, putting the best young talent in the boys and girls teams, which successfully fed our national programs. John's brilliance, his financial acumen, and astute leadership were blessed by the fact that he never played well, at least during our time, because I just heard that he was a good spiker. He never played during our time, he never coached, and he never officiated volleyball. Those of you who play, coach, or officiate any sport would know of the cussings and dislikes which those positions often attract. Furthermore, in spite of his strong opinions on almost every topic, John never shared those opinions outside of his chosen circle. As our leader, John was always one of the boys who never stood on rank. As brilliant as John was, he was naive about technology, and we often laughed at his ignorance in that era. Just imagine the laughter we enjoyed when John cheered our meetings from Bermuda. Most of the time, we viewed a blank wall or the ceiling in his apartment. I went everywhere with John, and whenever I ran into his daughter, Erica, I would tease her that I spent more time sleeping in overseas hotel rooms with John than her mother, Carol, ever did. I should have told Erica in beds, not just rooms. I recall attending a meeting in Martinique, and I was given this 6x4 room, and you can see my height, to sleep in with an even smaller bed. 2 days later, John arrived in Martinique for the Junior Championships, and I told him that they were yet to assign a room for him. John said, okay, tossed his bag on the floor, and took up residence in my cot. I cannot call it a bed. One morning, I awoke wondering why the room was so bright, to discover that John had taken down the curtains to use as a makeshift blanket. Too often, death denies us the opportunity to ask questions, to unravel things which puzzle us. Nearly 2 decades ago, my mother passed away, and I never found out who told her that when I was going to secondary school, I was so foolish that when the rain came down, I would not shelter. Similarly, I never got the chance to ask John about the time that we were going to a meeting in Dubai, why he made us fly from Barbados to Puerto Rico to New York to London to Dubai. However, in the 2 decades that John was the president of the BVA, he created a clear pathway for Andy, Dale, and Sherry to become international referees. He oversaw Roxanne, Andrew, and Paul taking up positions on regional committees. He provided Andrew, Jean-Marie, Sandra, Roxanne, Valmir, Caroline, and me with the knowledge and tools to carry on his work while passing the vision and legacy to Sharon, Julia, Anicia, Mark, and now Nicholas, to ensure the creation, growth, and success of future volleyballers and our association. John, our leader, our friend, the greatest president of the Barbados Volleyball Association, may he rest in peace.
We will now have a tribute from John's school friend, Mr. Andrew Small.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My tribute will focus on the younger John Francis Griffith. I apologize for the reverse chronological order of this, but I've attached on that part. Some of you may be wondering who I am. John and I shared a strong friendship over the last 52 years. We shared a number of things together, not just having the same middle name, Francis, not just having the same name of an apostle, but John and I, although we were poor little boys, we shared some rich experiences. Let me tell you some stuff, right? John was a mate. He was a playmate. We pitched marbles, we played rubber band wars, we play cops and robbers, right? We were roommates. John and I virtually lived in the recreation room of the Chapman Street Church of God. We played darts, table tennis, Clue, chess, Scrabble. We played Monopoly, but as he wants to call it, Monopoly. He was a travel mate, not to the extent of the previous speaker, but I remembered about 50 years ago, John and I traveled to St. Vincent with a group of other people from the church, Chapman Street. There were 20-something of us there in camps. And then John and I had the opportunity to go to Trinidad at St. Augustine's, representing Cave Hill at that point. And once more, we traveled to St. Vincent. That occasion was for James Paul's wedding. And Carol, you may remember this vividly. You remember the scary moments you had as we were traveling through those rocky hillsides and those turns. Those were interesting memories. John was a soulmate. We heard reference already of Ralph Thorne. Ralph Thorne felt that at school, when you saw John Griffith, you also saw Andrew Small, right? John was a study mate. When we were at Cave Hill, there were many occasions we had all-nighters. When we were preparing for the CGA, right, he was there as well. But of course, John was also a teammate. I had the privilege of being a member of John's team for the Church of God Sanjek's volleyball team, for the University of Cave Hill volleyball team, for, of course, right, Harrison College hockey team, and Harrison College Old Boys team as well. John was skillful. Early in his days at Harrison College, he earned the name of Mud Boy Mudders. Here's why. Once he and a whole group of younger boys were being chased by big boys, right, at Harrison College. So they were running away, and they turned a hedge, and there was a pool of water and mud. Most of those guys fell. John skillfully ran through without falling, hence the name of Mud Boy. John was witty. Picture this. Back in 1982, January the 30th, around 7 p.m., while making an official speech, John directed his comments to the bride and said, "If you did not marry him, I might have had to marry him." John made those comments to my wife, right? John was my best man. John was my bestie. John was a leader. In almost every event, John assumed leadership qualities. When we were young, a group of us, George, Jeffrey, Dayton, and me, but John was the leader. When we were studying, right, Tony Eady, Maureen Hall, James Paul, right? John was the leader, right? when we were at volleyball with the St. Jets, right, John was the captain, right? John, even in the cadets, we saw how John continued to take on leadership posts, and it wasn't surprising when he became sergeant major at the cadet corps of Harrison College, right? And also we've heard that he was the controller at BNB, and then he went on to be the president of the Volleyball Association, as well as the president of the Hockey Association. Let me also share with you that John was a visionary. Imagine this, right? After we left university and we all managed to secure our first jobs, John imprisoned one of our colleagues, Cleverson Haynes, because Cleverson had just secured a job at the Central Bank. John say that Cleverston will become governor of the Central Bank. How could he 40 years ago, right, foresee that Cleverson Haynes would be the governor of the Central Bank? John was a friend. They say that often in life we regret those things that we fail to do. We fail to tell our friends how much we love them, how much we admire them, how much they mean to us, how much we enjoy their company, how much, right, we would long to have there to relive those great memories. Those are some regrets. John was one of those upon whom I depend, a colleague, a buddy, A confidant, in short, a friend. Carol and Erica, be strong, be proud. Take cherished moments in reflecting on those memories, right? Continue to walk and take advantage of the legacy he's left behind. Parting is not easy. 41 years ago, when I left Barbados, I left John and my friends. That was hard, right? A few weeks ago, while in Jersey, and I heard about this situation with John, that was heart-wrenching, right? It shook me up, right? But now, this final parting with John is also tough. May God be with him. May God extend his mercies, his blessings, and his favors to his loved ones. I believe it was John who probably gave me one of my very first insights into Paul in the scriptures. And I think we attributed that to when he was at Harrison College and he was studying Acts of Paul, I guess, under Canon Jones. Paul, in writing to the Corinthians, he said, "Love never ends." John, I love you. I love all of you. Thank you.
This morning's tributes continue as we welcome Mr. Cammy Burke, who is here to represent the Barbados Olympic Association.
Good morning, everyone. As you heard, I'm Cammy Burke, and I'm the Vice President of the Barbados Olympic Association. It is an honor and a privilege for me to pay a brief tribute to our friend, colleague, brother, and late treasurer of the Barbados Olympic Association, John Francis Griffith. John was elected as treasurer of the BOA in 2004 and immediately took charge of our complex financial situation, initiating a number of accounting systems that are still in use today. Prior to joining the Barbados Olympic Association's board, John was a strong supporter of our organization as a delegate for the Barbados Volleyball Federation, and we have already heard of the great work that he carried out during his tenure as president of that organization. While at the BOA, John established the Regional Volleyball Training Center, which was based at the Olympic Center and impacted the lives of many young Barbadians. Our past president, Steve Stout, who unfortunately cannot be with us today, indicated that he relied heavily on John for counsel and advice on delicate financial matters impacting our NOC. Added to this, John reached the pinnacle when he was appointed chef de mission for our 2007 Pan American Games team. Up to the time of his resignation due to illness in 2017, John was integral to our allocations committee. This commission is the lifeblood of the Barbados Olympic Association, as it is responsible for allocation of all funds received by the NOC from its local and international partners. This, therefore, highlights the pivotal role played during the tenure of this Olympic icon. On behalf of Sandra Osborne, our president, Steve Stout, our past president, Erskine Simmons, our secretary general, our entire executive board, and myself, I extend sincere condolences to his wife and daughter. May our brother and former sports administrator rest in eternal peace. Thank you very much.
We close out this morning's tributes with colleagues from the Barbados, former colleagues from the Barbados National Bank, Desmond Smith and Velma Wilcher.
Good morning, everyone. This is a tribute to John from his Barbados National Bank and Republic Bank colleagues. We're going to trace a little bit of who John was, who the John we knew and worked with. He was our colleague and our friend, and everybody knows he was affable and inimitable. That is the John Griffith that we knew and love. Okay, I knew John prior to his appointment at the bank. Actually, I'm Velma Wiltshire. I knew John prior to his appointment at the bank as chief accountant or corporate controller, since we both worked at Sewell back in the 70s. He in the airlines and, of course, at the bank. And John was always out clean. And everybody who knows John know that he was always immaculately attired. Very sharp, from shirt and tie to boot. Needless to say, he attracted many stares and the admiration of many, but mainly the girls, especially the girls around the offices in whatever space he worked in. So during those years, the bank serviced most of the corporate accounts at the airport, as well as those of the individual staff members who worked there. So I encountered John in both capacities, as the accountant for managing those corporate accounts, as well as an individual, as we managed his personal account. Our friendship continued over the years. When he joined the bank, even though he was at head office and I was at Bridgetown, I was at the airport. I later moved to Bridgetown and subsequently landed on the third floor. Who sent me there? Sharon is going to tell you some of that.
Good morning. My name is Sharon Seeley. I am what they would refer to as the third floor boss. And for the third floor, who's sitting over there on my left, y'all know what I'm talking about. I was also John's secretary for 13 years of my 30 years at Republic Bank. First BNB, now Republic Bank. When I joined the third floor in 1994, the third floor was a quiet place. I was replacing John's former secretary, whose name was Isla Coppin. She was 60, and I was coming in at 20-something years. I said, John, this floor needs some spirit. We need some life. Nobody up here can play hockey. Nobody can play volleyball. But we got to do what we're good at. So what we did, we started to hold some parties and some limes on Friday evenings. Ice box cakes, chicken barn chicken, music. We just partied, but we worked just as hard. John Griffith is who we refer to as one of the best bosses in Barbados, not only in Barbados National Bank, in Barbados. I mean, can I have a hip hip from my third floor posse?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yes. We also have some former ones who are here. I always tell the retirees we always meet up at funerals. When persons are at funerals, they always say you should say what you have to say to persons when they're alive. John Griffith knew that the third floor posse, the BNB staff, the Republic Bank staff, he knew that we loved him. He didn't have to guess. He knew that the third floor, all the Barbados National Bank, loved him. We loved who he was. We loved who he became. Even after he left the bank, he would always interact with us. He was, as I said, the best boss in Barbados. I will pass over now to Desmond, also from the third floor, colleague.
Good morning, all. Now, let me begin by giving God thanks for placing in my life two managers who literally took me by the hand and led me to reach my full potential. One of those persons was John Francis Griffith. And basically, you know, the mantra, if I can help somebody as I pass along, my living will not be in vain. Now, I first met John when I went to campus in the 1980s. I wouldn't say when because that ages us. Now, he was my tutor and in cost and management accounting. And the following year, he became a lecturer as his substantive lecturer was on leave. His student-friendly approach to teaching and his clear illustrations resulting in a pass rate that was higher than that of previous years. As a result, many students were able to complete their course of study. Now, with degree in hand, I was transferred from being a teller to the corporate accounting department of the Barbados National Bank. While there, the chief accountant tendered his resignation because he's going to greener pastures, creating a vacancy. You know, during a search for replacement, a review was done of the existing applications on file, and John's application was unearthed. Now, within a few days, he came for an interview, and of course, the rest is history. John became my boss in the corporate accounting department. Now, as a CGA, John personally suggested that I and other interested members of staff enrolled in the program. He ensured that I graduated by giving me, you know, personal assistance and tips in areas wherever I was challenged. You know, overall, I worked with John for about 15 years and at the Republic Bank and its predecessor institutions. From my experience, John was the consummate professional who fostered greater appreciation for the role of accounting in the bank. He was instrumental in getting the professional accounting studies included in the bank's list of approved courses, which resulted in recognition and reward for those of us who did those courses. And even though John was controller, I found that, you know, Stafford never overawed by his presence. His demeanor was of such that we felt comfortable. Yes, he ensured that tasks were done and successfully completed. However, he valued his staff and never intimidated us or tried to micromanage us as supervisors. Now, I'll move a little faster. Now, John had, as we, Velma said, John wore some of the finest threads and always was well attired for work. I used to be dressed in my shirt jacks and felt quite comfortable that I was well attired. I wouldn't tell you all that happened. But what I will tell you is that one day I turned up in my office and found a strange looking, I can still see it, a blue book. And on closer inspection, I realized the title was Dress for Success. Now, using the process of elimination, I concluded that John was the person who placed that book on my desk. Needless to say, I took the cue from him and changed my wardrobe to more relevant business attire. All right. He also asked me to accompany him to his tailor, Pauline Seeley, as a hint that I should change my tailor. I did that, and I have had no regrets. Now, I want to express my sympathy in closing to, you know, Carol, Erica, and the entire family. I also want to say, if we want to really pay tribute to John, we should help someone as we pass along, just as he did, so that our living would not be in vain. I thank you very much.
We go back. For me, John was my friend for a number of years. And he was that point person for me, a confidant with whom I could easily discuss anything, share a joke. And y'all know John could laugh because we could hear him from one end of the office to the other. Share a joke with. You could seek counsel and advice on financial matters with the knowledge that you would get a frank and honest answer from John. And because of our interaction, I was able to make some sound decisions from a financial perspective. John can also be credited as that individual who taught, influenced, and was instrumental in the success of a number of persons, staff included, who pursued careers in accounting and finance, as well as other disciplines of higher learning. The John we knew and loved, not for his position in the organization, but for his innate qualities. He was a senior bank executive who was respected and who moved seamlessly among all. He mixed easily. He was caring, very comfortable within his skin, and had the greatest sense of humor. On the third floor, we were a family, one that worked hard, and as Sharon said, we partied even harder. We planned many parties for no reason at all. It didn't have to be a birthday or anything. And when we couldn't do it in-house, we moved to West Terrace to Margaret Campbell's house. We also had many Friday limes, and needless to say, John was very generous. He was always the first person to put his hand in his pocket and put his hand in the air and say, "This is my contribution." Mm-hmm. Now, we were also members of a very vibrant BMB staff club that organized many after work and in-house activities. We also participated in the local interbank sporting activities and traveled the Caribbean on Easter tours to other indigenous banks for their events over the years. John traveled overseas for work and I left the bank and I moved to another organization, but I stayed in John's loop through his wonderful and forever caring wife, Carol, my friend. John was a special man, a good man, a good friend, and most of you who knew him well understood the type of friend that he was. He was talented, but humble, very confident. He was a gem in his chosen profession, an asset to any organization. So as I say goodbye, as we, his colleagues, say goodbye, John, your sojourn here has ended, but it didn't go unnoticed by us, your colleagues, and your friends. You will be missed by us. May you soar with the angels, and may light perpetual shine upon you. Thank you.
Please stand. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, no things to come, no height, no depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then whether we live or whether we die, we're the Lord's. For this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing to this world, and we could take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. Jesus said, I am the resurrection, and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. With faith in Jesus Christ, receive the body of our brother, John Francis, for burial. Our brother was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God, our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise him to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, remember before you this day our brother, John Francis. We thank you for giving him to us as family and friends, to know and to love as a companion in our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The opening hymn now, Through All the Changing Scenes of Life. Please be seated. We'll have the eulogy.
Two of the greatest assignments John ever gave me were to help him win the presidency of the Barbados Volleyball Association, and then to capture the position of treasurer of the Barbados Olympic Association. I certainly feel honored that Carol has handed me this assignment of delivering her eulogy for John. I acknowledge the presence of the president of the Barbados Olympic Association, Sandra Osborne, SCM QC, her vice president, Cameron Burke, Sir Trevor Carmichael, as well as the president of the Barbados Football Association, Randy Harris. I must also acknowledge the presence of the treasurer of the BOA, not only to bring back some balance for the foundation boys, but earlier you heard me mention that the Volleyball Association was penniless. So I don't want to cause any affront, and we continue being penniless. So welcome, treasurer. Albert Einstein said, "The value of a man should be seen in what he gives and not in what he is able to receive." Sorrow fills our hearts, a sorrow that is deep and personal. John joined the staff at the BN Barbados National Bank, not the Republic Bank, some 20 years ago. In his role as financial controller, he was passionate, and as such, he contributed so much to the development of the team on the third floor. You already heard that as well. He was generous with his knowledge and skills, also his money, and was instrumental in inspiring his team to seek higher education. He was a member of the executive MBA program and a former student. Forgive me. John silently closed the door and departed from us, leaving our lives empty in areas where he brightened. John gave much. He was kind, generous, and always willing to help others. He touched the lives of so many in various areas, and I would like to take a few minutes to share some of those aspects. A man of many parts, John was accomplished. He was a true academic, he was a Fulbright scholar, and a certified general accountant, attaining the CGA Fellow designation. So impressed was the late Mrs. Keene Springer, the head of the CGA program at the time, that she enlisted John's services to teach some of the courses in the program. John also lectured at the University of the West Indies Cahill School of Business, where he prepared his students for the Executive Diploma in Management and Executive MBA program. A former student recalled that John knew the structure and complexities of almost every corporate entity on the island and elucidated clearly to the benefit of his students. John joined the staff at the Barbados National Bank, now Republic Bank, some 20 years ago. In his role as financial controller, he was passionate, and as such, he contributed so much to the development of the team on the third floor. He was generous with his knowledge and skills and was instrumental in inspiring his team to seek higher education. It was as an administrator that he played a pivotal role in the golden era of Barbados' volleyball, and I and all of us can attest to that. Carol indicated that she met John some 45 years ago, where he taught her the finer points of the game of hockey. He tried to awaken in her an interest in accounting, but to no avail. Even though she had more than a nodding acquaintance with numbers, she did not budge. However, he gave her his unflinching support, which she's indicated that she will carry with her always. Their union produced a beautiful daughter, Erica, whom he cherished with all his heart. While Erica did not have his passion for volleyball, I don't know why, or hockey, John wholeheartedly supported Erica's exploits in track and field, lawn tennis, and dance. He was proud of her academic achievements, and nothing brightened John's latter days more than when Erica returned home and spent time discussing various issues with him. To his sister Olivia, brothers Samuel and Beresford, nieces and nephews, I know that his passing has also left a void in your hearts. As we lay John to rest, we bury only his body. His spirit, his soul, his amazing ability to give is still with us. It lives in the recollections which people shared of how he touched their lives. By his passing, all who knew John will miss a highly intelligent and vibrant individual that we all love, and we will remember the great impact he created in our lives. May his soul rest in peace.
Let us bow our heads in prayer. Almighty God, we remember before you today your servant, John Francis. We pray that having opened to him the gates of larger life, you will receive him more and more into your joyful service. With all who have served in the past, he may share in the eternal victory of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. We now have the first Bible reading.
A reading from the Word of God, written in Romans chapter 8, verses 35 to 39. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble, or hardship, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Here ends the reading.
Let's remain seated as we sing the Crimson version of Psalm 23, The Lord is My Shepherd. This will be followed by the second Bible reading.
a reading from the Word of God, taken from John chapter 10, verses 14 to 17, King James Version. I am the good shepherd, and know my sheep, and am known of mine. As the Father knoweth me, even so know I the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, that I may take it again. Here ends the reading.
Please stand as we sing the hymn, Lead Us, Heavenly Father, Lead Us. I speak in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Let me offer condolences to the family of John Francis Griffith. My wife is here, so I do so on her behalf. And other family members and friends, as we offer our love and support to Carol and all the members of the family, all those persons who are gathered here as friends to offer their own support. I've known Carol for many, many years. I would consider she's a friend in need is a friend indeed, and she therefore asked me to officiate at her husband's funeral service. I also served as her parish priest for a number of years and had the good fortune and blessing to prepare Erica for confirmation when I served at St. Bartholomew's parish many years ago. I pray therefore not only for Carol and Erica, but as I said, siblings and other family members. My association with John was, didn't see each other many times, but one occasion I was invited and he was there to what we call the stag party before a wedding service of, not a wedding service, yeah, a wedding service of Rupert Spencer, who's to my right. Now, of course, when you invite a priest to a stag party, it's a bit sedate. But we did get a chance to discuss certain things about football, about cricket, and sports in general, and just generally speaking about life. And it came out to me, as I heard it, even the words of remembrance and the tributes what stood out for me was one that John, from top to bottom, was a sharp dresser in terms of his shoes, right up, sharp dresser. Also, a person of, I could even say, supreme intellect, listening, reflect upon different things. Very, very impressed indeed. Not only in that encounter with John, but other persons that have been taught by John, that have been mentored by John, I had conversations with those persons, and again, he has had a significant impact upon a number of lives, and therefore, we give thanks this morning for his life, and we give thanks to God, not only for his life, but for the promises for John, and indeed for all of us, if we open ourselves to those promises. Now, as I said, I didn't have a chance to really discuss spiritual matters with John, but one thing that I think I can safely say, given his age and the era where he was raised, that growing up, being, of course, at school especially, at that time, we emphasized the importance of him singing. And a hymn has been selected for this particular funeral service. Lead us, Heavenly Father, lead us all the world's tempestuous sea. And I want to just reflect briefly on those words. And I do so from the point of view that it is a very compact hymn, a very balanced hymn, something I think that John himself, because of his profession, would appreciate. And many persons, I think, know this hymn, because actually when I was looking, I looked in the congregation, and many persons of his era, and those persons maybe a little younger, maybe a little older, will know that this hymn is a very, very familiar hymn, so much so that some persons, as they looked in the congregation, they were able to sing the hymn without reference to the sheet. And that is important sometimes, especially as you're being raised, to have these spiritual values inculcated into you, especially during the difficult times, you can bring them to mind. And therefore, lead us, Heavenly Father, lead us o'er the world's tempestuous sea, guard us, guide us, keep us, feed us, for we have no help but thee. Of course, it is a fact that life can be a wonderful experience. We can come into contact with wonderful people, but of course there are some challenges, significant challenges. And we would know, of course, that when we're in a storm on land, it is very, very difficult to have a storm, therefore, on sea. Really brings out a vivid image. Lead us, Heavenly Father, lead us all the world's tempestuous sea. Guard us, guide us, keep us, feed us, for we have no help but thee. Now, the wonderful thing about God is the fact that he sends people into our lives, and people can come into our lives, who can truly assist and help us to prepare ourselves for those difficult times. Now, those difficult times could be in the field of endeavor of sport, excuse me, and therefore persons who come into our lives as a coach to guide us and to help us. So therefore, when we're going through that difficult time, we can bring out the best within ourselves, which they have encouraged us to think about and to implement it when it is needed. And I think that when we think about John, many persons can say that he was sent. He utilized his God-given gifts to encourage persons, to guide people, to coach people, and to teach. And therefore, we give thanks to God for him. But added to that, for we help no help but thee, as we receive, as he received, not only the love and support that he, of course, showed to others, that he was on the receiving end. It is in the scriptures, it's in Matthew chapter 25. When did I see thee sick and minister to thee? When did I see a stranger and welcome thee? And of course, we would know that John had a period of illness, but of course, persons came into his life as caregivers, his family, his friend, especially his wife, to offer the love and support. And that's why, as I said, lead us, Heavenly Father, lead us, all the world's tempestuous sea. Guard us, guide us, keep us, feed us, for we have no help but thee. Savior, breathe forgiveness o'er us. All our weakness thou dost know. Thou dost tread this earth before us. Thou dost feel its keenest woe. Lone and dreary, faint and weary, through the desert thou dost go. It is a fact, of course, I think we must be honest with ourselves, that we can have, of course, major strengths. but we also can have significant weaknesses. But our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, breathes forgiveness over us. He knows all of our weaknesses, and he loves us. He loves us not only to send persons into our lives, but also loves us in that quiet time to help us to know that he's a God who forgives, he's a God who supports, a God who's gone through the temptations and the challenges of life and has been there for us, and no doubt for John, in that period of time that our Lord is there and has been there for him. And the final verse is, Spirit of our God descending, fill our hearts with heavenly joy, love with every passion blending, pleasure that can never cloy. Thus provided, pardon guided, nothing can our peace destroy. Spirit of our God descending, nothing, our heavenly joy. Now we live in a world, of course, where again, there are significant pleasures. But our pleasures in this life are always going to have, I would suggest, a shelf life. Something that can help us, we can only go so far. I was born in England, and as a little boy when I came here, I was very, very excited indeed to have mangoes. And I was eating the mangoes and eating the, I don't even like to smell a mango. And that can happen. Sometimes we can have good things. But say that sometimes that we can overdo it, that it can make us sick or make us really ill. And therefore, even in the reality of life, certain things can go but not so far. But this particular verse is trying to make the point. Spirit of our God descending, fill our hearts with heavenly joy, love with every passion blending, pleasures that can never cloy, never make us sick. Because thus provided, pardon guided, nothing can our peace destroy. Yes, John brought significant blessings to many persons with whom he came into contact. He has made a significant mark in terms of his world of work, sports, and other endeavors. But of course, as you deal with the reality not only of life, but even the fact of death, certain things, of course, that would give you pleasure can no longer give you pleasure. And therefore, we need to have that peace which passes all understanding. And therefore, today, as we give thanks to God for John, for the blessings of God, let's also give thanks for the promises, not only for John, but also for us, and that he may rest in peace, that he'll have that peace which is past all understanding, and that we will not only have benefited from, but continue to share and to expand all the blessings that he has been the part of, but also for ourselves, and therefore to take very, very seriously the words of this beautiful hymn. Lead us, Heavenly Father, lead us. Savior, breathe forgiveness o'er us. Spirit of our God descending, pleasure that can never cloy. Thus provided, pardon guided, nothing can our peace destroy. May he rest in peace and rise in glory. Amen. The hymn now as we stand is, Thy Way Not Mine, O Lord.
I do not choose my lot,
Please be seated as we bow our heads in prayer. We pray for those who mourn for John Francis, family, friends, former work colleagues. We commemorate the departed. Let's pray with confidence to God, our Father who raised our Lord Jesus from the dead for the salvation of all. And grant, Lord, your servant may know the fullness of life which you have promised to those who love you. Lord, in your mercy, hear. Be close to those who mourn. Increase their faith in your undying love. Lord, in your mercy, may be strengthened in our faith. Live the rest of our lives in fellowship with your Son, and be ready when you call us to the fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy, show your mercy to dying, strengthen them with hope, and fill them with the peace and joy of your presence. Lord, in your mercy, we commend all people to your unfailing love, and them your will may be fulfilled. And we rejoice to the faithful witness of your saints in every age, pray may share with them in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. And Father of all, we pray to you for John Francis, and for all those whom we love but see no longer. Grant to them eternal rest, let light perpetual shine upon them, and may he and all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen. We stand now and sing the recessional hymn, Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
Christ has risen from the dead, trampling down death by death and giving life to those in the tomb. The Son of Righteousness is gloriously risen, giving light to those who sat in darkness and the shed of death. The Lord will guide our feet in the way of peace, having taken away the sin of the world. Christ will open the kingdom of heaven to all who believe in his name, saying, "Come, O blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you. Into paradise may the angels lead you. At your coming may the martyrs receive you and bring you to the holy city, Jerusalem." Everyone the Father gives to me will come to me, and I will never turn away anyone who believes in me. He who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give new life to our mortal bodies through his indwelling spirit. My heart therefore is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore.
Thank you.
Ready?
I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this. Happy the dead who die in the faith of Christ, henceforth that the spirit they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Man, born of a woman, has but a short time to live. Like a flowery blossom then withers, like a shadow he flees and never stays. In the midst of life or in death, to whom can we turn to help but you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts, and your mercy hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins, the last hour let us not fall away from you. Ensure a certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ. We commend to Almighty God our brother John Francis, and we commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this our brother John Francis and we ourselves be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage. They may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness and the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Rest eternal grant to him, O Lord. May he know the favor departed through the mercy of God. Rest in peace. The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious to him. The Lord lift his countenance upon him and give him peace. the hymns, What a Friend We Have in Jesus, All to Jesus I Surrender, Blessed Assurance, when we all get to heaven.
I surrender. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior. land that is fairer than day. And by faith we can see it afar, for the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. In the sweet by and by, sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirit shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessing of rest. In the sweet by and by, we shall
if you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on your sleeve, And if you're trying to be the change you wanna see, if you lay down your life for love so someone could be saved, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. Days down here through, there's a place out there for people like you.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Of God, yeah. Show.
Let us pray. Unto him who is able to keep us from falling and present us faultless for the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Amen.
Tonight.
always made my troubles feel so small. And you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, where God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah.
I wanted you for life, you and me in the wind. I never thought there'd come a time that our story would end. It's hard to understand, but I guess I'll have to try. It's not easy to say goodbye. For all the joy we shared, all that time we had to spend, if I had one wish, I'd want forever back again. To look into your eyes and hold you when you cry, it's not easy to say goodbye. I can remember all those great times we had,
There were so many memories, some good, some bad. Yes, and through it all, those memories will last forever. There's peace in where you are. Maybe all I need to know. And if I listen to my heart, I'll hear your laughter once more. And so I've got to say, I'm just glad you came my way. It's not easy to say goodbye.